Hello viewers, my name is Samir Khan and welcome back to my channel Sam's Classroom. Today in this class we are going to learn about respiration, which is the energy releasing system. Food is required for the survival of an organism and also for the production of heat and energy in our body. We get nutrients from the food and the final utilization of food takes place during the process called respiration. What is respiration? The term respiration is derived from a Latin word respire, which means to breathe. Here, we generally think that respiration means breathing in and out, but actually respiration means utilization of food for the production of energy. So, we can define the term respiration as the oxidation of food materials, especially carbohydrates, proteins and fats, to produce heat and energy is called respiration. The term respiration came into use from 14th century. Before that, we used to call it breathing. At that time, people they didn't know about life process. As we have discussed in our earlier video, that life processes are the processes which helps in the survival of an organism, like respiration, circulation, excretion, etc. So, respiration is a medical term which means breathing in air for the production of heat energy. It was not until 18th century, because of the experiments performed by Joseph Priestley and Lavoisier, we came to know about the properties of gases. These two people, they have performed a series of experiments with the help of bell jar and have discovered oxygen in the year 1774. So, oxygen was discovered by Joseph Priestley's experiments in the year 1774 and it was named by Lavoisier in the year 1775, which we have learnt in our previous video. Now let us know what were the experiments performed by Lavoisier to understand the properties of gases. See, Lavoisier kept charcoal in a bell jar and kept it in a water vessel and burnt it. When he burnt it, it produced a fixed gas, which is carbon dioxide. Okay. At that time, people used to call carbon dioxide as fixed gas or chalky acid gas. Later, he burnt sulfur. He observed that something is helping in burning the sulfur, but it was not moisture or water vapor. So, it is either air or some elastic fluid present in the air. He also said that the same component is used for breathing, which he called as respirable air. Generally, the air which we breathe out does turns the lime water into milky white precipitate. He also said that the air which we breathe in is different from the air which we breathe out and is also useful in the production of energy and burning of materials. But when we burn the metals, the lime water is not turning into milky white. Finally, he concluded that respirable air is entering into the lungs and the fixed air is coming out of the lungs. He also said that the amount of air entering into the lungs is equal to the amount of air coming out of the lungs. He also said that the respirable air is responsible for turning the blood into red color. But later, we came to know that the red color of the blood is because of a pigment called hemoglobin. A renowned chemist, whose name is John Draper, around mid-19th century, in his book called Human Physiology, has written like this. He said that the chief materials which a living being receives are matter which can be burnt, water and oxygen gas. And also, upon the action of these materials with one another, all the physical phenomenon arises. He also said that the body expels out water, oxide of carbon, phosphorus, sulfur and other components. It means, we came to know about the process of respiration by the mid-19th century. At that time, the events which were involved in the process of respiration were not clearly understood, but people somewhere believed that there was some relationship between the process of respiration and the heat produced in our body. Now let us learn about the events or steps involved in respiration. As we all know, respiration is a very complex process with several biochemical and physical processes. Why we are calling it as a biochemical process? Because this process takes place inside a living organism, and during respiration there are several chemical reactions taking place for the production of energy. So it is called as a biochemical process. And why do we call it as a physical process? Because here the physical activity is involved during inhalation and exhalation. So it is called as a physical process. Now let us know what are the steps involved in respiration. As you can see here, the first step involved in respiration is breathing, during which air, it moves into the lungs and out of the lungs. The second step is gaseous exchange at lung level. Here, the exchange of gases takes place in between the alveoli and blood. The third event that takes place during the process of respiration is gas transport by blood. Here, the transportation of oxygen takes place from the blood capillaries of alveoli. This gas is generally transported to the body cells and the blood receives oxygen from there. The fourth event which takes place during the process of respiration is gaseous exchange at tissue level. Here, the exchange of gases takes place, like oxygen and carbon dioxide are exchanged from tissues into the blood and from blood into the tissues. The last event which takes place during the process of respiration is cellular respiration. As we know, cellular respiration is nothing but the production of energy by using oxygen. Here, the final utilization of food materials takes place inside the cell. A cell, it uses oxygen and oxidizes the food materials to produce heat and energy. Now let us know what does the breathe out air contains. As we have already seen from the experiments performed in our previous classes, that when carbon dioxide is passed into lime water, it immediately turns into milky white precipitate. As we all know that breathe out air contains carbon dioxide, let us perform an experiment taking some lime water with the help of a straw, breathe out the air into the lime water vigorously for at least 1 minute. When you breathe out the air into the lime water using a straw, the lime water, it turns into milky white precipitate, indicating that the breathe out air contains carbon dioxide. Let us learn about the pathway of respiration. From the picture, you can clearly understand the pathway of respiration involves nostrils, nasal cavity, pharynx, larynx, trachea, bronchi, bronchioles, alveolar sac, and blood capillaries. Let us learn in detail about each one of them. The first one are nostrils. Nostrils are the openings through which the air enters into the nasal cavity. Then comes the nasal cavity. Here, the air gets filtered, as well as when the air passes through the nasal cavity, its temperature is brought close to the body temperature. And also, the water vapor is added into the air so that the air can get moist before entering into the lungs. Here, whatever the dust particles which comes along with the air are prevented from entering into the lungs with the help of the hair as well as the lining of the nasal cavity. So, the hair which are present inside the nasal cavity are also called as the sweepers of the nasal cavity. The next one is pharynx. Pharynx is classified again into nasopharynx and oropharynx. The bony plate called palate separates the nasopharynx and oropharynx. Pharynx is generally a muscular structure. It is also is lined with mucous membrane. It also helps in preventing the dust particles from getting into the respiratory tract, as well as it also helps in adding water vapor into the air before entering into the lungs. The next one is larynx. Pharynx opens into larynx through a slit-like opening called glottis. Glottis is covered by a muscular flap-like structure called epiglottis. Epiglottis helps in preventing the food from entering into respiratory tract. Larynx is also called as voice box. This stiff box contains vocal cords. When air passes out of the lungs and over the vocal cords, they start vibrating. And it is because of the vibration produced by these vocal cords we are able to produce the sound. But we are able to produce the sound in a rhythmic manner only because of the coordination of our lips and tongue. Larynx is made up of 9 cartilaginous bones, out of which the 3 major cartilaginous bones called arytenoid cartilage, cricoid cartilage and thyroid cartilage together will form a notch-like structure which protrudes out and forms Adam's apple. Adam's apple can be seen prominently in the case of men compared to the women. Larynx continues as trachea. Trachea is commonly called as windpipe. Trachea is generally supported by C-shaped cartilaginous rings, which helps in preventing the trachea from closing and collapsing. Trachea divides into bronchi. Bronchi divides into smaller and smaller branches called bronchioles. These bronchioles, they'll end up in cluster of air sacs called alveoli. Here, the exchange of gases takes place. And whatever the oxygen which is received by the blood is supplied to the tissues with the help of blood. The interior of the lung is divided into millions of small chambers called alveoli. These alveoli, they help in increasing the surface area of the lung, which helps in exchange of gases between the air and blood. The lining of the lungs are much folded and their total surface is enormous. If all the alveoli of our lungs are spread out, they'll cover an area of nearly 160 square meters. Coming to the lungs, lungs are very spongy in nature and the left lung is smaller when compared to the right lung. It is because of the presence of heart. As we all know that the heart is present slightly towards the left side. Lungs are generally protected by 2 membranes called the pleural membranes. And the space between these 2 membranes is called as pleural space. This space is filled with a fluid called as pleural fluid. Pleural fluid, it protects the lungs from physical injuries and damage. As well as, it also helps in providing lubrication in between the lungs during expansion. Let us now learn about epiglottis and passage of air. See, from pharynx, the food enters into esophagus. Here comes a tricky part. We have a common passage for both air and food. Here, the larynx, it is covered by epiglottis. As we have already discussed, epiglottis is a muscular flap-like structure which prevents the food from entering into respiratory tract. Epiglottis generally gets closed whenever we swallow the food. And it deflects the food down into the stomach and keeps it out of the trachea or windpipe, which is the common route for the lungs. The epiglottis, it also opens more widely when we take in breathe and the air enters into the lungs. Now let us learn about the mechanism of respiration. As we all know that respiration involves 2 processes. One is inhalation and the second one is exhalation. Ribs as well as diaphragm also plays a major role in the process of respiration. Ribs play a major role in a respiration in the case of women, whereas the diaphragm plays a major role in respiration in the case of men. During inhalation, the volume of the chest cavity increases and pressure decreases, because of which the air from outside enters into the respiratory tract. Finally, it reaches into the alveoli where the exchange of gases takes place. And during exhalation, the volume of the chest cavity is decreased and pressure increases, because of which the air from inside the lungs, it gushes out into the atmosphere. Now let us learn about the gases exchange in alveoli and capillaries. See, the gases exchange takes place within the lungs with the help of diffusion process. As we have already learned in our previous classes, that diffusion is movement of molecules from higher concentration to lower concentration. As you can see here in the picture, when the alveoli receives oxygen, it has higher concentration of oxygen. And the blood which is passing through the capillary has higher concentration of carbon dioxide in it. So when the blood is passing through the alveoli, it exchanges the carbon dioxide with oxygen and carries that oxygen to different tissues in our body. The similar process can be seen in between the blood and tissues. When blood receives oxygen and reaches the tissues, it gives off oxygen and receives carbon dioxide from the tissues, because the carbon dioxide concentration is more in tissues when compared to the blood. The oxygen generally gets dissolved in the blood, and when it gets dissolved in the blood, it is immediately received by hemoglobin. Hemoglobin is a red color pigment present in our blood and contains a protein with it. The protein combines with the oxygen and becomes oxyhemoglobin. And this oxyhemoglobin is supplied to various tissues in our body. And the carbon dioxide, which is produced during the process of oxidation, is expelled out of our body in the form of carbonates. If hemoglobin is exposed to the air at sea level, nearly every molecule of it combines with oxygen to form oxyhemoglobin. But at a height of 13 kilometers above the sea level, the concentration of oxygen decreases. Under these conditions, only half of the molecules of oxygen combines with hemoglobin to form oxyhemoglobin. In these conditions, the mountaineers generally they carry an oxygen cylinder along with them. Hence, the modern aircrafts are specially built with pressurized cabins that helps in maintaining an enriched air supply or oxygen to the passengers. And when we go deep into the water, we all have to carry an oxygen cylinder, as we all know that we cannot breathe inside the water. So the deep sea divers, they carry an oxygen cylinder along with them whenever they go for diving. If you like my video, then please do like, share, comment and subscribe to my channel. Thank you.